Hello, everyone, and welcome to the Lharbur Show. My name is Luke Harbur. I am your host. Today, I have on my brother, Cole Harbur. He is my brother, as I said, as well as an entrepreneur. Cole, how are you doing today?
I'm doing great.
Amazing. Are you ready to do our first segment of the show, Harbur Hot Takes?
Let's do it.
Okay, so we've got three topics for you to explore today. Number one, how do you tolerate Luke Harbur, also known as me? You have one sentence.
Love and admiration for you.
Oh, that's very sweet. Okay, number two, we've got cheating in relationships. You get one sentence.
Don't do it.
Great. And number three, one of my personal favorites that was submitted, the Game of Thrones finale. One sentence.
It's time to deviate from Hollywood a little bit.
Yeah. Nice! So now we are going to jump into our second segment of the show, Harbur Talk. Okay. Cole is going to get 9 minutes to talk about three taboo topics. It can range as to how long we talk about each topic. Sound good?
Sounds great.
All right, we're starting the timer in 3, 2, 1. So the first thing I would love to talk about in depth, personally, is sibling rivalries. So you personally, being brothers, I want to ask you, why do you think that's a taboo topic?
I don't know. I feel like we kind of live in a society where people generally fight with their words. And when it gets to another level, which is actual, you know, physical and emotional sort of rivalries and conflict, that it becomes difficult for people to actually process that, because we're so, you know, in such a social media paradigm where, you know, you can just trash talk people without any consequence, and nobody really resolves their problems anymore with their fist, which is good, I think, overall. But, you know, I think people can sort of lack accountability and grounding in their words when that isn't like a part of our culture.
Right. And I know for us, we used to fight a lot as little kids. And I mean, for anyone watching, if you have siblings, I'm sure you can definitely relate to that. As we got older, in a way, it was nice to get out irritation that easily against each other. But as we were able to really be with each other and see that we were on very different pathways, that really, really helped. And for me, that's kind of how I found peace between our relationship. As I was like, we're just two very fundamentally different people, but that doesn't mean we can't support each other on our different journeys.
Right. And on the hot takes, I mean, love and admiration, I think, means, you know, we're both creatives in very different ways. And I think the way I sort of see our relationship has evolved is, yes, we were very different, but you sort of balance, because we're so different, you balance me out. You know, you're sort of like a counselor, someone that can sort of look at the world in a different way that my baseline thinking doesn't usually perceive things.
Right.
And so I think as we've grown into, you know, adopting more responsibility, it's become helpful that we're so different, you
yes.
know. And it used to be a source of conflict, but now it is something that I appreciate more and more that I have, you know, such a good relationship with you.
Right. And I love that I can rile you up in a way, but you really help me calm down and be reflective and better understand that without being able to be riled up and without being able to find peace within yourself, it helps you be a balanced person with both attributes.
Yeah.
It helps.
I could
a
use
lot.
Some riling.
That's good. Hey, yeah, you know it. Okay, well, let's go into our next topic. We are going to talk about what you want to today. The concept of boredom. Why do you think that's taboo right now and today?
Yeah, well, I think in general, people have a lot of trouble just being in general, just being in space, being in sort of unstructured moments of their lives. It's very uncomfortable to actually feel like there's not a path or there's not something to actually entertain the mind a little bit. And I guess it just sort of fascinates me, feeling like our society sort of constantly encourages us to fill space. And that because of that, we really do avoid some very essential lessons, I think, fundamental to what really needs to be done, I think, as far as leadership and what makes a fulfilling life is that contemplation that happens when you are bored, noticing what you want to do in that moment. I think is very taboo to actually critically think about that moment. Because we're just, you know, in the age of Netflix and the news cycles and just so many things that fill that moment unconsciously and automatically that it becomes taboo to really look at that. If that makes sense.
It does. Yeah. And I know for some of my peers, people fear that boredom in that space because they really don't want to know what it is they're actually thinking or feeling. And some people have even tied religion to that space because of, I know people who meditate, I know people who pray, and for them, and for some people, that's another way of filling that stimulus. It's not a root cause of, okay, strip away the religion, strip away the stimulus, who are you at your core, and what is it that you really want to do, and why, you know? That's really hard for people because there's so many expectations to keep running, to keep filling the void, to keep achieving.
Yeah.
It's not true. It's just not necessarily true. But what do you think of that?
Yeah, I mean, there's a need for us to explore this topic secularly. I think it gets really complicated when you get, you know, wrapped up in doctrine and a particular dogma or belief system. I think these are the places in our communities that, you know, that space has been provided, but we're not going in that direction. There is a need for us to look at that and how we integrate it into our lives from a secular point of view. So definitely on the same page there. And it is really hard, you know, we don't have any support. We don't have the mentors, the people in our lives, you know, reinforcing that as an important thing to do. Yeah, but I think ultimately what we are, most of us are on autopilot, and we have to be, you know, much of the time to survive. But I think there is the value of taking that pause and looking at the boredom is that you can enrich everything after that with so much more satisfaction, deeper relationships, more productivity at work, ultimately more fulfillment. And it's not about making your life a big bored pause. It's about making that practice a part of your life. And not, you know, we're not monks.
Okay? Right.
But we're taking those essential lessons of those contemplative traditions and sort of making them micro processes of the way we, you know, live. So that, I think that's what we need to do.
And last thing before we move on to the next and final topic, I saw this brief article about In Praise of the Slacker. And the idea of that in the 90s is there was the big punk movement in music. And the idea of that is you listen to music, you hang out, you drink, you smoke, you chill. I'm not saying promote that lifestyle again, but the whole point of that is why can't we just promote social simplicity again? Whether that means you and I just talking to each other or hanging out. And I just, yeah. It's interesting how that's been framed and how that's been rising up in a way. So, And then our last topic of the day is somewhat niche, but really interesting. It's the idea of performative progressives. And in layman's terms, the idea that people like to be temporarily a part of social movements. Why do you think that's taboo?
Yeah, well, I think it ties into our last topic. It is very exciting to be a part of a movement, and you can get a lot of attention. But I think ultimately you sort of flop You know, you sort of self-sabotage when you approach a cause in that manner. I mean, you can't possibly sustain that approach. You're going to lose your audience, and you're not going to be an inspiring leader. I mean, it's a flash in the pan, essentially.
That's a very good way of putting it. It feels that way. And I know in college culture, we briefly spoke about that it's kind of everywhere. Like, people are posting to their Twitter, their Facebook, or their Instagram and saying, you know, look more into the social movement. But I don't know, I would want to donate to a cause, or I would want to try to show up at an event, even if that means being there 15, 20 minutes. Because the whole point is you're showcasing it more through your action and not just your brief words or your brief illustrations.
Right.
You know? Any last thoughts on it?
Yeah, well, last thought is that I think that, you know, there are so many social justice, if you will, concerns out there today, especially considering the sort of political climate and how that has sort of energized the whole social justice movement. I think what's really important to be an inspiring person amongst the people that want to see positive change is to be authentic. And you have to really understand your story, where you fit in within the matrix. You can't be ultimately an advocate for everything. You can be an ally to people that really have that core inspiring story to promote a movement. But I think what it's going to take is knowing our story and what we should promote to create the positive change we want to, without getting caught up in, you know, everything we need to be promoting, you know, to be a good person.
Right.
We need to become aware of, you know, leaders in different areas, different movements, but ultimately, when it comes to our promoting something, it should come from, you know, a deep, authentic place.
And just be yourself. It's a beautiful thing. Well, Cole, you did a spectacular job. Nice, man.
All right.
Love it. Cole, are you ready to do the end slate?
I'm ready.
All right, let's do it.
Pause, play, try to be kind, and keep making a difference.
We'll see you guys soon.
All right. Bye.
Yeah. That was awesome.
I was like, four or five?
No, you were great. Great. We're all done. That's the L. Harbur Show.